First species in two parts, lower counterpoint. Counterpoint is base, finding and fixing errors. In Gradus ad Parnassum, an important 18th century treatise on counterpoint by Johann Joseph Fux, the student in the dialogue submits an example having errors in the counterpoint line below the cantus firmus. Can you spot the student's mistakes? We learned that two-part first species counterpoint must always begin with a perfect interval between the two voices. That perfect fifth between G and D in the first bar, however, throws the example into a different mode, from D Dorian to G Mixolydian. Such modal wandering is not allowed in the initial bar. Better. To correct the first error, we begin the counterpoint an octave below the cantus firmus instead of a perfect fifth. Very good. You may recall, however, that the student makes a second error in these measures. In bar 3, the interval between cantus firmus and lower counterpoint is a perfect fifth, but both parts move into this perfect fifth by direct, i.e., similar, motion, which is not permitted. With only two parts, this is a fault in voice leading between bars 2 and 3. How would you fix it? Right. We retain the low D in the tenor part through bars 1 and 2. This makes for oblique motion through the two bars. Then, in bar 3, that perfect fifth can be approached by contrary motion, rather than directly, i.e., not by similar motion. Now listen to the corrected exercise. Do you recall the reason why direct motion, whether parallel or similar, into a perfect interval is not permitted in two-part first species counterpoint? By avoiding direct motion into a perfect interval, the two voices maintain their independence, an important goal of counterpoint. This also prevents hidden parallel octaves, unisons, and fifths, again, promoting independence of parts. Unlike the flagrant violations shown here. Let's zero in on the final bar of the exercise. Both cantus firmus and lower counterpoint land on the final D note in the same register, a perfect unison. This unison is permitted because it is the ending. Incidentally, bar 10 is an example of chromatically raised seventh scale degree in Dorian, a minor mode. A cadence requires a leading tone in the counterpoint. This in spite of the fact that the natural seventh degree was just sung two bars before. Insight. Whenever the natural seventh degree of a mode is a whole tone below the tonic, it is not officially a leading tone. Instead, we call it the subtonic. Now, follow along with cantus firmus on top, counterpoint on the bottom, and the corrected intervals. Then you will have an assignment. Listen. And again, now with added choir samples. Transcribe the entire exercise to the grand staff below, transferring the alto part to treble clef, tenor part to bass clef. Practice singing the cantus firmus in solfege, the note D is the la, while playing the lower counterpoint on the piano keyboard. Then switch. Finally, ask a friend or colleague to sing the duet together with you. You are, of course, encouraged to practice writing lower counterpoint lines to one or more of your own cantus firmi. Post a question in a comment, and be sure to like, share, and subscribe for updates. Thank you for listening.